Boker Tov. Can you hear me? Yes. It's a great honor and privilege and pleasure to be here with you today. I studied Hebrew for 4 years prior to my bar mitzvah, and I learned nothing, unfortunately. I could have really used a little bit of Hebrew this week, but people here, this is my first time to Israel, and I'm delighted to be here under these conditions of meeting with all of you and talking to you about something that is very near and dear to my heart, which is psychiatric rehabilitation and the entry of consumers or peers. I'm going to use both terms interchangeably, peers and consumers, to help consumers and peers find jobs and careers in the mental health system. Much of my work for the last 16 years has been to open up economic employment opportunities for consumers in the mental health system. And I'm going to talk about two of the programs that I started and directed in New Haven, Connecticut. I thought first, before I really begin talking about my story and about mental health, that I'd give you some of my impressions of Israel. This is my first time, and in one of my past lives, I was a journalist. I was a foreign news correspondent in Brazil, and I reported on Brazil for the United Press International for a year and a half. And so when I come to a place like Israel, I kind of have my journalistic hat on. And what really impresses me about the country is just what a young country it is. You see young people everywhere. You see young families everywhere. You see a great deal of construction going on. For me, Israel is a land of the future. It looks like you're going to have a very wonderful future if all these construction projects and all these families continue to grow. Also, I've been really, how should I put, grateful for the friendliness and the helpfulness of the Israelis. Yesterday, my girlfriend and I were coming to the train station in Haifa, and we're carrying really big bags, and we had to go up a flight of stairs, and a very nice woman who was very large came over and said, "Can I help you carry your bags up the stairs?" And so she helped us do that. In another encounter in the train station, on a train from Rehovot to Haifa, we were sitting across from a woman who made aliyah to Israel from Sweden. And she was putting cream on her face and hands. And my girlfriend commented, and she said, "Would you like to try it?" And so she gave the cream to my girlfriend, and she put it on her face and hands. But this is the way it's been for us. People have been very going out of their way to be helpful and to be friendly, and I like that very much. The woman who made aliyah from Sweden said she decided to come here because she was here abroad for one of her years of university, and she found the people very friendly and very positive. And she said that back home in Sweden, people were very inward, and they thought the worst of you, and they didn't communicate that well to one another. Well, I kind of knew that because I had seen a lot of Ingmar Bergman films. But I can see the contrast between Israel, a southern country, a country with lots of sunlight, lots of outdoor weather, and Sweden being very cold and dark, you know. And so this is a real change for her. And I have to say that when I went to Brazil, Tel Aviv reminds me a lot of Rio de Janeiro. It's Rio, as some of you may know, is a beachfront city with lots of high-rise apartments along the beach. The same thing here. It reminded me so much of Rio that I thought for a minute I was in Rio. We were in Haifa for 2 days, and Haifa was beautiful. We went to the Baha'i Gardens. The Baha'i Gardens there, just lovely, so well done. And then we went to the German colony and had lunch at an Arab cafe on, I forgot the name of the street, maybe Ben-Gurion Street, I think. And there was a guy across from me who was smoking a hookah. You know what that is, a hookah?
Aguila.
Okay, aguila. So I said, "Hey fellas, can I take your picture?" And the guy got up and said, "Here, why don't you smoke it for a while?" And so I smoked it, and my girlfriend took a picture. Now I'm going to show all my friends in America that I smoked aguila. Jerusalem also was very impressive. I mean, people there from all over the world. The neighborhoods were very interesting and unusual. We went to the Wailing Wall, which was a great thrill to me to be there. We stayed in the center city, so we were near Ben Yehuda Street and Yaffa and the market, and it was just a lot of fun. And it seemed like I was stepping back into history, but at the same time keeping one foot in the modern era and one foot in the old historical era. I think you can only do that maybe like in Jerusalem. You know, it's just a very unique city. One other thing about my trip that I want to share with you is that I discovered 2 weeks before I came here, I discovered that I have cousins in Israel, that there was a branch of the family that didn't immigrate to the United States in the early 1900s, but came to Israel instead and started a kibbutz. And the kibbutz is Kibbutz Sa'ad in the western Negev. And my, I guess, second or third cousin, Yehuda Elami, was one of the co-founders of the kibbutz. And I don't know if you know Kibbutz Sa'ad. Well, I haven't been there, but they have a very famous cactus garden. And I understand that that was planted by my relative, Yehuda Elami. In Jerusalem, another cousin came to get us at our hotel, took us around to see some of the landmarks of Jerusalem, and then we went to his home where his wife fixed us a very delicious dinner. We spent the evening looking over the family tree. I had the American branch, he had the Israeli branch. And so that was very exciting for me to see that my family was twice as big as I thought it was. I'm going to talk about, well, let me thank a few people first. I want to thank, first of all, Galia Moran for inviting me and for hosting me here. I feel like I've been in very good hands with Galia, and I haven't gotten too far lost, or I haven't missed too many appointments, largely because Galia has kept me on track. I'd like to thank Vera, too, and the ISPRA organization here in Israel for creating this event and for having all of you come to it. And I'd like to thank all of you for coming here this afternoon to talk with me and to hear a little bit about psychiatric rehabilitation and peer provider services in the United States. I want to maybe preface what I'm going to say to you today by telling a little bit of my story. Because I was a journalist and a teacher before I became ill at the age of 28. I became ill with clinical depression and then developed psychosis. And my diagnosis was acutely reactive psychosis with depression. And I was hospitalized 5 times, usually with psychosis, where I had imagined a very sort of a fantasy of persecution and trouble, and wound up in the hospital. In one of my hospitalizations, I was in the waiting room of a hospital. I was in psychiatric crisis, and I heard people speaking German in the other room. And that triggered off a paranoid fantasy that these were Nazis waiting to get me if I went into the hospital. So I ran away from the hospital. I don't know why, but I had my shirt off and I had my shoes and socks off, and I'm on the street running around, and this policeman comes up to me and says, "What are you doing?" And of course I thought he was going to hurt me, so I jumped on him. And he wrestled me to the ground and arrested me, and I wound up in jail for 3 weeks, or for 3 days, until my father came and bailed me out. That was a very terrible experience, but it shows you that this craziness is something that is sometimes you can't control, and that you can do some really wild things that you never thought possible. In addition to the psychotic episodes, I also had 3 clinical depressions for which I wasn't hospitalized. I wasn't taking medication. I had a dysthymia condition for 19 years. Dysthymia, as some of you may know, is a mild intermittent depression that comes and goes, and you don't know when it's going to come and you don't know when it's going to lift, but it would hit me kind of in the morning and it would kind of ruin my day. I couldn't do very much. I'd have to wait out the depression till it lifted and then get on with my life. And then in 1994, the spring of 94, or the winter of 94, I was very depressed because my job search had fallen flat. I didn't have any job prospects, and I was looking for work, looking for full-time work in the field, and became very depressed. And during the course of the treatment for depression, my psychiatrist tried me on various medications, antidepressants. And as you know, probably, it's a trial and error method to find the right medication. So he tried me on three, it didn't work. Tried me on the fourth, it worked. And so started taking that, and the depression went away. And I haven't been troubled by depression since then, since 94. Also, in 92, I speak Portuguese, and I know a lot about Brazilian culture because I lived there for 4.5 years. And I taught a course in Portuguese and Brazilian culture at a university in Cleveland. And my classes were very early in the morning. They're 8:30 and 9:30. And a lot of times I would be depressed in the morning with this dysthymia condition. This is before I found an antidepressant. And I'd go into class, and I would give my lecture. I had more than 40 students in each class. And I found that I could work with depression, that these feelings were uncomfortable, but I could push them aside and deliver the lecture and complete the class satisfactorily. So that gave me a lot of confidence that I could go back to work. And so from then on, from 92 on, I looked for a job in the mental health field. And I'll tell you why I chose to work in the mental health field. First of all, I think it's like a little bit like tikkun olam, you know? The world is a little broken, and so you try to sort of like help repair the world a little bit, and you do this one person at a time. That was one reason. Another reason was I liked working with consumers. Consumers were very authentic. People, when you did something that they liked, they would tell you, hey, that worked, I like that, thank you so much. If they didn't like you, if they didn't find what you're doing very helpful, you wouldn't see them again. They'd vote with their feet, and that would be it. And so I found that I enjoyed the authenticity and the genuineness of working with consumers. So in the spring of 94, I came to New England. I drove from Ohio to New England, 600 miles, and I interviewed at a dozen places, and I had two job offers by the time I finished my trip, and the third possibility at Yale University in New Haven that was just starting the interview process. And when I got home, I waited a while, and about a month later, I found out I got the job at New Haven. So I moved everything I had in a U-Haul truck, and I drove to New Haven. I knew one person in New Haven, but I was willing to take the risk because I'd heard good things about the program in New Haven, and I knew that I had something to offer consumers. I had already been a peer support group leader in Ohio. I started projects there that I employed consumers, so I thought, yes, I can do this kind of work. This is what I want to do. I want to talk just a little bit about the consumer movement in the United States. It started in the 1970s. It was a latter-day civil rights movement. It was sort of based on the Black Power movement, the women's movement, and the gay power movement. It started in the early 70s when groups of consumers, see, in the 60s, they started taking people out of the hospital and putting them back in the community. It was called deinstitutionalization. And so the consumers found that there was nothing for them in the community except medication and therapy. There wasn't any kind of support, really, among their peers. So consumers started meeting in cities along the East Coast, Washington, New York, Boston, and on the West Coast, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and Vancouver, and they started meeting to give support to one another. And what they found was that there was terrible condition, inhumane conditions in the hospital. So they started to advocate for more rights for consumers in the hospital, for to wear their own clothes, to have their own valuables with them, to get their own mail without being read by the staff, things like that. And they started seeing just how great the stigma was in the country as a whole. And they started to speak out against unfair stereotypes of consumers. For example, there was a stereotype of consumers as being violent, of being unpredictable, of being immature, retarded, or being a marginal person, unproductive person. And so since that time, since the early 70s, consumers have been really engaged in a battle, a fight, to really change the way the society views consumers. And I tell you, it's a battle that is far from over, because the society still discriminates against consumers. The rate of unemployment among consumers in the United States stays around 80-85%. And so you see that people can't find jobs, and there is discrimination in universities, there is discrimination in the employment area, there is some discrimination in housing. And so the consumer movement has been fighting this discrimination, trying to get more fair treatment for consumers for the last 30 or 40 years almost. I got involved in the consumer movement with the self-help groups in Cleveland. And I'll tell you something, that was really a turning point for me. I met a consumer provider, an advocate, who had been a journalist, who had a family, whose life was getting better, who had an office to work from, and who was organizing consumers in self-help groups around the Cleveland area. This was like a revelation for me, because I never met a consumer that was working, or that had a family, or that was helping other consumers in any capacity. I must say that prior to that, I was getting treatment in the private system with a psychiatrist that was giving me my medication and therapy, and that was all. But there was a lot going on in Cleveland in terms of the consumer movement there. One of the things we did was we started a drop-in center at nights and on the weekends, because as you know, if you're not working, there's not too many places you can go to feel comfortable and meet your friends. We did this at the drop-in center, and I'll tell you, I'd go there in the evenings, and I'd play cards with the other consumers, and we would talk about our lives, about our problems, about our futures, and it was that interaction that made for me normal being a consumer, and I accepted my illness. This was back in 1987, 98, and it was really from that time on that I really started my recovery, because I could accept myself and my illness, and I knew that I could go on and have a life again. Today, you know, one thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pause every so often to take your questions and comments. So if anyone has a question or a comment, please feel free to ask it. Yes, back there.
Hi.
Hi.
Welcome. We have a consumer organization in Israel. We tried on the 90s, something like four times to have a consumer organization.
Yes.
And we failed each time. In the last year, we started again. And my question is basically three short questions.
How do you what?
How do you start?
Okay.
As a consumer movement,
okay.
How do you start to have projects to raise money?
Uh-huh.
The second question is,
yeah.
Who are your natural partners?
Okay, let me answer one at a time. Okay, hold the third question for now. How do you get started? Well, as I'm saying that in the U.S., along the East Coast and West Coast, it was the consumer support groups, the self-help groups, were coming and talking about their lives, talking about their problems, talking about the discrimination, talking about how do we help each other, you know, find better housing, how do we deal daily with medications and with stigma and things like that. It was really the self-help groups that were the start of it all.
Okay, we started the same in the 90s.
Yes.
We had a movement, a consumer movement, the first one, to be a little fit, the consumer leader, the pioneer.
Uh-huh.
The first pioneer.
Yes.
And he's still a leader.
Yes.
And he's doing many nice things. And he started, and I was a partner then, it's called Expo de Doute, COPI. And that's the name of the consumer in Israel. Since then, we call ourselves Expo de Din. We call it
Copers. Copers, I like that.
Yeah, it's an Israeli
it's an Israeli
technology.
Yes.
Thanks to the first consumer organization. And
yes.
We started with the self-help group in Tel Aviv, then in Jerusalem, mm-hmm. in Shula, Alperovic here. Mm-hmm. And we had the organization named Benafshen, but it was closed again. It also was closed. Mm-hmm. And then Malam and Mishma. And now again we have Mishma. My question is, how do you raise the budget?
Yeah, that's a good question. I'm going to talk about that in my talk about where I got money to start consumer programs. But let me tell you that at first, the first couple of years, when the consumers started to find out about each other, they had a national conference, I think it was in Berkeley, California, and everybody paid their own way to get to the conference, and I don't know how they got the money to rent the rooms and to other kinds of logistic costs, but that was the first thing. The people came on their own to the national conference. In a few years, after two or three of these national conferences, the National Institute of Mental Health had a department called Community Support Program, and they would finance the consumer conference each year after that. So we're talking about 1975, 1976. That consumer conference has continued to this day, and currently it is still funded by SAMHSA, or the Community Support Program at the National Institute of Mental Health, and they put on the conference. And a consumer technical assistance center in Massachusetts called the National Empowerment Center, they organized the conference. They used the money from NIMH and they put on the conference. Now, the conference is then from consumers all over the country. Many of them have scholarships from their mental health departments in their cities, and they come for three or four or five days to hear workshops, to hear speakers, to interact with one another, to have a party together, and so forth. That's where they get the money from a national mental health organization. And what's your third question?
The government, basically,
yeah.
Okay.
But the government gives the money, and then the consumers do what they want with it. There's no supervision on the part of the government.
Okay, my last question is, what are the dangers? What should we be careful about, not to fail?
Here's one danger that maybe you haven't thought about, is that to really be genuinely consumers, you should have the staff be outside. In other words, the self-help groups, the organization should be consumer-run. They should be totally consumer-run and controlled, and that staff should be there, if at all interested, in a very supportive capacity. That's one danger. Another danger is, I don't know if this is a problem in Brazil, I mean in Israel, but in Brazil it was, that consumers had a hard time talking to one another in a group. What happened in Brazil, I was there in June, was that when they had a self-help group, each consumer unloaded all of his troubles, all of his issues at one time, and the other consumers kind of sat back, whoa, you know, I can't relate to that. So one of the things that I think they're going to do in Brazil to avoid this problem is to say, okay, if you want to speak, you have 2 minutes. Say your piece in 2 minutes, and then we'll move on to the next person. So perhaps one of the dangers is working together in a group in a constructive manner. Is that something that's an issue with you guys? It's an issue in the Knesset too? You know, here's how we deal with that in the United States. Because when I came to Connecticut, I started a peer support group or self-help group for people with depression and anxiety disorder. And at the start of every group, I would say, okay, here are the ground rules. Okay, one person talks at a time. No one monopolizes. We don't want side conversations. We don't want people criticizing one another. We want to give everybody a chance to talk. Is that okay with you guys, you know? And then after kind of laying down the ground rules, people kind of knew how to behave and how to act within a group. That was very important. Because I'll tell you something, you know, and this was true of me too, that when I became sick, I withdrew from society because of stigma, because I was afraid, I was ashamed of what I had. I didn't interact with people, so part of my recovery process was learning how to be social again. Was learning how to speak in a group so that I didn't dominate the group, so that I spoke appropriately and other people appropriately too, and I listened to other people. This was kind of a socialization process that occurred as I got well again.
And a well point here, I think this is a cultural problem in Israel in general, so the Knesset needs that kind of rules as well. Yeah.
What about balance? What's the experience of the balance?
That's a good question. I tell you, in my family, I'll answer this question and I'll move on, or maybe someone else has another question. But I think families in general don't know what to do if a family member becomes ill. You know, maybe the people with serious mental illness may be 2% of the population, Well, the other 98% of the population doesn't have any contact or any knowledge of mental health, so they don't know what to do. What my father said to me was, look, you know, you're not working, get a job and your problems will go away. You know, that was his attitude. Later on, he saw that I was ill and that I needed help and so forth, and that he actually saw me recover and then return to full-time work, and he was very proud of me. But for a while, he wasn't proud of me at all. He thought I was a lazy guy, a lazy bum. Mothers have a better reaction, I think. Mothers are more accepting of the person's illness and are more supportive than fathers are. But it, you know, and there's a family organization in America called NAMI, the National Alliance on Mental Illness. And for people who are new to mental illness, I recommend that they take a family-to-family education course so they can find out about the illnesses and how to cope with them and how to advocate and how to help their ill relatives. So it's a big problem with the families. Most of them are unprepared. They are very ashamed of having a mental illness in the family, and they tend to kind of ignore it or avoid thinking about it until they can't do that anymore. Any other questions now? Yes, over there.
I wanted to ask, how do we cope with the problems of society being stigmatic about people who carry mental disorder or mental psychiatric problems?
Yes, well, okay, let's talk about stigma for a minute. Stigma, of course, is unfair. It's stereotypes, it's discrimination. And I think there are ways of combating stigma. I'll give you four examples. One way to combat stigma is to protest. In other words, to say, go out in the public sphere and say, we're mental health consumers, we demand our rights, okay? That's not very effective usually. Another way of doing it is through education. Going out and educating the public about mental illness, about stigma, about discrimination, etc. That's a little bit more effective. A more effective way yet is what's called contact. When you have a program that you take out to the public and you show them a film and you talk, I started a program like this in Connecticut where we had a film that talked about mental illness in five ways. The acceptance of the illness, the dark days, the acceptance, treatment, coping, and success, hopes, and dreams. And so there would be people on the video talking about these subjects, and then after each segment, two people in the room would tell their story in conjunction with that segment of the video. For example, dark days, a person would say, well, I tried to commit suicide, or I was in the hospital 10 times, or something like that. And then it would go on to acceptance. Well, here's how I accepted the illness, okay? You see what I mean? It's a very effective way of changing attitudes because people see that the people in the room are ordinary people. They're just ordinary people that have this challenge in front of them. You see what I mean? They're not devils.
Like,
they're not lunatics. Yes.
I say that it seems like diseases are meant to human beings, not the animals.
Exactly. Exactly. So that's
besides, if I have diabetes, why should they think about my psychiatric problem? Not my
exactly. It's like an illness like any other illness. That's what we try to... And there's one other way that we educate the public or that we counter stigma, and that's through what I call empowerment. Now, empowerment is like advocating on behalf of the mental illness. It's writing about it. If you see an article in a newspaper that stigmatizes, write a letter to the editor saying, that was unfair. Okay? Or contact, or empowerment may be going to the legislature. In my state, the laws about mental illness are all made in the state legislature. So we go to the state legislature and we testify. We go in great numbers. We wear all the same color clothes so they see that we're a big group and that they need to take us seriously. See what I mean? That's another way. Yes.
Oh. Sorry.
Yes.
I know that meeting you with all your knowledge and experience has raised a lot of questions.
Sure.
But I think maybe we'll go back to the lecture and then open up questions if it's okay with you in the
end.
It's
fine, yeah.
And because we only have half an hour to cover what we wanted.
Oh, okay.
And, yeah.
Oh, boy.
So this is fine.
Okay.
And I think to everybody, maybe if you want to ask questions afterwards in the breaks or whatever, Richard, you're here, right?
Okay, sure. So, I'll be here all day. Okay, I'm going to go on to lecture and I'll stop again and we can have more questions. What I'd like to do now is talk about some of the philosophies and the practices of the work that I've done, okay? The work that I've done is really based on, you know, real well-thought-out philosophies and values and practices. We just don't go out there and start giving services. You know, one of the values of psychiatric rehabilitation that I find most important is skill training, skill building. And so when I have a program, the first thing, like the warm line that I'm going to talk about is an after-hours telephone service in the evening. I put people through an 8-week training. I give them skills. We simulate what it's going to be like to work on the warm line. We talk about recovery. We talk about peer support. Now, peer support is a new discipline that has been developed by consumers working with other consumers in the system. And basically, peer support is when a peer or a consumer works with another consumer. And we find that these relationships are mutually transformative. They change both parties because they're based on mutuality. And mutuality is really equality. Mutuality is seeing eye to eye with the other person. And it's giving the other person the consideration that their recovery journey is unique to them. So while I may have a recovery journey, and I may talk about it in some ways to shed light on the problem of the peer that I'm working with, I respect that peer and his or her recovery journey as unique to them, okay? That's kind of what peer support is. It's kind of a learning and growing together, okay? It would be like the journalist that I found in Cleveland. I saw him on TV, that's how I found him. But working with him, he became a kind of role model to me. And I saw that his recovery story was one that it seemed real to me. It seemed like something I could achieve too in my own way, okay? So that's peer support. It's helping the other person figure out what they want to do. And I teach a course in this actually at a community college in Bridgeport. And what we try to do is we try to say, look, do not fix the person. Do not look for shortcuts. Do not advise, don't give advice. Don't tell the person what to do. Listen to the person. Find out what their strengths are. Find out what they want to do. Find out from them, you know, what's worked in the past for them and where they want to go. And then support them in achieving that recovery, okay? You know, I don't want to talk against social workers or psychologists or psychiatrists, but oftentimes there's a distance between the consumer and the psychiatrist. Or there's a distance between the mental health professional and the consumer. And because the training that they receive, they do not see equality. They see themselves as being authorities that are giving knowledge and information and advice to people below them, right? Right? And so the consumer, the peer support belief is that we're mutual, we're equal, we're on the same page, and I can learn from you just as you can learn from me. See, it's a different approach, isn't it? And so there's no hierarchy, it's like this, okay? Anyway, for a lot of consumers who have been in the system for a while and who have been dependent on professionals or have been, thinking that they had nothing to offer, the peer support approach is like a welcoming approach. It's like something really new and wonderful for most consumers. And when we employ consumers in the system, we make sure that they're doing peer support. They're not being case managers, they're not being little social workers, they're being peer support specialists. And that movement of peer support specialists is going on all over the United States now. And I was going to talk about this later, but I'll mention this briefly now, because peers make very good workers. They're motivated, they know the mental health system backwards and forward, they've had their own recovery experience, and one other thing is they want to give back. You know, you've heard of the expression give back? People feel that I've been helped, like I do. I've been helped by other people, so now I want to turn around and help someone else. That we call that giving back. And so with that motivation and that mission, people are very motivated to work and they make outstanding workers. And now the mental health departments have discovered that, so there are certification courses and certification processes in place in all the states in the United States, and we're employing more and more consumers. That's one of the newest trends in the U.S. I want to talk briefly about psychiatric rehabilitation, because this is something that I'm what's known as a certified psychiatric rehabilitation practitioner, CPRP. I had to take a test for this, and then I got the certification from USPRA, which is the United States Psychiatric Rehabilitation Association. And so with my programs, I build in skill building, and I also build in supports among people that I'm working with, and supports in the community if they have supports, the natural support system. And I find that as my role as the director is to do whatever I need to do to help that person succeed. I want to make sure that that person has a good experience working in the mental health system. And so that's a little bit of psychiatric rehabilitation. There's also, I've already spoken about identifying strengths and capabilities of the peer counsel and building on those. The work is very person-centered. In other words, we're designed around the unique needs of each individual, helping them identify their needs and wants and goals. The peer providers promote self-determination and empowerment. Let me make a brief statement about empowerment. Empowerment is helping a person realize they have more power than they thought they did. Empowerment is giving people new information. Empowerment is changing the perspective of people. For example, after working with Bob Schlesinger, I thought, hey, recovery is possible for me. That was a new concept. Or one time I'm in a conference, and there's this mental health consumer who's a doctor by the name of Carol North, who wrote this book called Welcome Silence, because she had kidney dialysis, and it she didn't hear voices after that, so she wrote a book called Welcoming Silence. And during the course of her talk, she used the word coping mechanism. Well, I had never heard that expression before, coping. But I was doing it already, and I had a word for what I was doing, for a process that I was already doing. That was empowerment. And there are other ways of empowering people, creating opportunities for people. I think giving a person a job is one of the most helpful ways of empowering someone. Okay, I want to talk briefly now about recovery vision and recovery values. Yes? It was a miracle, because they gave her a kidney dialysis. In other words, they replaced all the blood in her system, and when they were through, she didn't hear voices again. Now, they tried it in other people, and some people died from it, and so they discontinued that practice. It's no longer going down in the United States. It was kind of a miracle. They don't know how it just happened, but then they did it again, and it really killed people, so they stopped doing it. This was back in the early 90s. There's another question back there. Yes?
You talked about the strengths.
Yes.
How can you enter with somebody that needs a treatment and you don't believe from your experience about the way of the strengths?
Yes. Yes. Well,
you need to share with him all the situation that he passed. And from your experience, you know that most of them are not the best.
Not helpful,
For your illness.
Yes.
So how will you handle it?
Okay, that's a good question. One thing you can do is what I do is share my experience with psychiatrists, with shrinks. I tell them that there were some that were helpful and others that weren't helpful. It was a matter of going through a few of them before I found someone that I liked working with. So I think that's being honest, that they don't work for everyone. Some people, aren't very verbal, okay? Because I think when you work with a shrink, you want to be verbal and sort of voice your problems and your issues and so forth. Some people don't do that very well one-on-one. But maybe in a group, they feel more comfortable, and listening to their peers allows them to sort of learn things that they could never learn from a shrink. You see what I mean? So there are other options for people other than shrinks. That's what I tell people. Yes?
Can you be more specific and speak about the drugs, let's say, like this, the pills?
Yes, the medication.
Everyone from his knowledge, from my knowledge, you know, I know that it's not the best because I pass things and I handle with somebody that I need to give him a treatment. I know that it's not the right way for him.
Yes.
So it's another time of conflict.
Yes.
Because also you need later to give up from these drugs and to go forward from it.
Okay. Let me just make one comment about it.
That the word in Hebrew it's rehab.
No.
When you stop to take the pill, it's a process.
Yes.
Not from today to tomorrow.
Exactly.
It's a long process.
Yes, that's right. That's right. Let me just make a...
What is wrong?
Sometimes the pills don't work for everyone. There's a certain percentage of people that are not helped by psychiatric medication. And so there are alternatives. There are peer support groups. There are, you know, for me, one of the best medications when I was depressed, it worked better than a medication, was exercise. I used to go to the Jewish Community Center in Cleveland, and I would work out for an hour, and I would feel better. So there are alternatives. And sometimes, just by talking it out with somebody who's willing to listen to you and to empathize with what you're going through, that also helps a person a great deal. And that's, I think, one of the strengths of peer support, because, you know, we can sit with people who are in pain. We can sit with people who are suffering because we've been there and we know that what the person is going through. And we can communicate that to the person. So, you know, I hate to say it, but medication doesn't work for everyone, but there are other alternatives, I think, if you look around a little bit. Yes, over there. Then I'm going to go on with my lecture. Yes, one last question. Yes.
And because of that, I think that one of the things that I become a consumer of the body is to help people with mental disabilities like I do, and to have the practices of emotional intelligence, social intelligence, and understand one another, not that I'm better than you, or not like in a
That's excellent. It really is. And that's peer support when you have that equality and when you think that the person has something to offer and you can empathize. In other words, you can understand where that person's at and communicate to that person that you understand what they're going through. And that goes a long way. I'm going to continue with the lecture for a few more minutes and then we'll have another question. I want to talk about recovery. First of all, back to that fellow. I take medication every day or every night, you know, and it helps me. It helps reduce the paranoia that I might have, and it also sort of keeps me stable. So I'm glad that the medication's out there for me. And it took me a long time to find the right medication, believe me, and I suffered a lot because I was on the wrong medication for a couple of years. So medication for me, when I talk to people, I say, look, it's not a science yet, it's more of an art. You've got to try it, see if it works. If not, get something else until it works for you. See what I mean?
How many sets you pass?
How many what?
How many sets you pass? If you come to the right...
Okay, it was a process that took about 7 years.
7 years of...
trying,
changing.
Yes, that's right. Okay, let's talk a little bit about the values of the recovery-based services. First of all, we feel that everybody can be in recovery, and President George W. Bush, in 1992, instructed a mental health commission, National Commission on Mental Health, to come up with guidelines for the country in mental health. And one of the things they said was, everybody should be able to get into some form of recovery. And by recovery, they meant that people should be able to live, work, study, pray, and socialize in their communities. And I would say also that people can contribute to their community. That's recovery. We feel that is attainable by the vast majority of people. Now, the recovery values that I teach in my course are hope, choice, empowerment, recovery environment, and spirituality. The five recovery values that I teach in my course are hope, first of all, then choice, then empowerment, then recovery environment, and finally spirituality. I was very fortunate when I first became ill to work with a very wonderful psychiatrist who gave me a lot of hope. He said, you're going to recover from this, and we can do it by changing your self-image from negative to positive. And he said, one day you're going to be fine when we do this. And he was right. I did change my self-image, made it more positive. It's given me strength, and it's given me the ability to kind of continue on with my life. Another value is empowerment. No, choice. You know, so often in the mental health system, people don't have choices. You're kind of told, this is the service, this is what you got to do. Okay? Choice is saying, what do you want to do? When we take somebody out on the Welcome Basket Project, which I'll talk about later, do you want to go out for breakfast or do you want to go for a walk in the park? You know, little simple choices like that. Give a person a chance to know themselves a little better, okay? We always provide choices for people. We don't tell people what to do. We have choices. Another thing that we try to do is empowerment, which I've talked about. The recovery environment, okay? A recovery environment is where people... First of all, if you're meeting, it's in a nice room. It's a nice environment. It's not dirty. It's not darkly lit. It's well lit. It's comfortable. But more than that, in the recovery environment, there's a higher consciousness. And that higher consciousness is, how many people here have heard of Carl Rogers? Okay. Carl Rogers was a very visionary psychologist in the 50s who really said that when you're working with people with mental disabilities, you should treat them with the highest positive regard. In other words, you should have high expectations and high respect for that person. And so in our programs, we try to love people, we try to care for people, we try to think the best of people, and they respond to that kind of environment. You know, like a teacher that demands a lot of its students, we don't demand things of our students, but we have expectations and we treat them so well that they want to do well. Okay, for a lot of people, this is like a revelation to be treated so well, and they respond to that very, very well. The other thing is spirituality, and I'll use myself as an example. When I was first ill with depression, I was very despairing. I thought there was no place in this world for me. I didn't want to go out of my apartment. I thought everything was bleak and negative, and I lived in despair for a few years. And then as I started to get better, I started to recover, I started to do things that had meaning and purpose again for myself. Working with a, I didn't bring it, but working with a self-help group in Cleveland, I worked with other consumers on a discharge handbook. And during the course of working on that handbook, I started to recover. There was a woman at the agency by the name of Mieko Smith, who was a research person. She said, Richard, she said, why don't you come to work here during the week? The support group met one afternoon. She said, I'll find something for you to work at in the week. So I went to the agency, and she put together a little workstation for me with a typewriter, phone, clerical materials, everything I needed to work on the project. Well, boy, was that empowering, wasn't it? And then every morning she'd come through my part of the office and say, Richard, is everything all right? Do you need anything? Tell me. And then at the end of the morning she would say, do you want to go out to lunch with me and my staff? Or do you want us to bring back something for you? See, that was a recovery environment. That was positive. That was giving me a great deal of respect and showing me great kindness too. And I really responded to that. I really responded. In the 8 months that it took me to work on the project, I started to make new friendships. I started a relationship with a woman. I started to think about my future after the 8 months. I was able to go back to work part-time as a mental health outreach worker. My life turned around in those eight months. And a lot of it had to do with Mieko Smith figuring out a place where I could work and be during the day when I could work, because I was depressed a lot, only could work a couple, three days a week in the mornings. So I go into some detail, but she recognized that was a strength of mine, being able to research, to do writing, to do things like that. And I responded to that, and that was the start of my recovery. And then I felt good about it. I was using my skills productively. I was making a difference. I was starting to inform people that about mental health programs and services. I sent a copy of the handbook to my psychiatrist, the one I worked with in Boston. He sent me back this very nice letter saying that this book looks very professional. He said, why don't you become an information giver for other mental health consumers and the general society? And I thought, whoa, you know, information giver, I can do that. So I started writing articles, I started speaking out, and that I wasn't working at the time. It gave me what we call a valued social role. In other words, it gave me a role in society that was valued by other people. And that made a big difference in my self-image and also feelings of being productive and having a purpose in life. And I think that these illnesses are so terrible that they take away all our meaning and purpose. And one of the steps in recovery is to regain new purpose and new meaning in your life. Any comments or questions about that? Yes.
I wanted to ask whether you believe that in the 21st century, the society is more capable of helping the people who have mental disabilities.
You know what I think? I think that it's a battle. I think it's something that you've got to continually work on because at least in the United States, the stigma has not decreased that much. It's still a pretty harsh stigma. And that what you hope to do is you hope to change people's minds and attitudes. And I think the best way to do that is one of those four things that I was talking about earlier, you know, and to be an advocate, to go out there and say, look, I have a mental illness, but also have a life, okay? One of my definitions of recovery, I want to get into this too. My definition of recovery is a process. It's something that you work on, right? Not something that you attain, because there are no cures for what we have. I take medication because whatever I got hasn't gone away. I'm still going to have to deal with it for the rest of my life. But I can create a life for myself. I can go back to work. I can have a life. I can have friends. I can have family. I can have activities that I enjoy. See what I mean? That's recovery. And recovery just isn't the no more illness. It's, hey, I'm coping pretty well with the illness now, but I also have created a new life for myself. Yes? I'm sorry, I didn't hear.
Do you find peer specialists in the hospitals too, or just in the community?
No, we have them in the hospitals too, yes. I supervise peers in the hospitals too. And would you like me to talk a little bit about that? I'll say what they did. We called them pros. We called them pros because peers reaching out. And what we did was we had people work one-on-one with people in the inpatient floors in the hospitals. In other words, they talked to them, gave them peer support, listened to them, found out what their needs were, what they wanted to do, when they were being discharged, and helping them, you know, kind of get it together to get discharged. But also we worked in small groups with them too, where we would have art therapy groups led by consumers or peer support groups led by consumers. One of the people that worked with me was very creative, and she would have she'd bring in her own tapes, and she would have really easy listening music, and she would make tea, and they'd have tea and listen to music and do something creative, either writing or drawing or something like that. That was invented by the consumers working in the hospitals, and then the staff started to do the same thing because they saw that it worked and people liked it.
Yeah.
Well, you know what you need is, you know, working with hospitals is difficult because it's very hierarchical, very bureaucratic, and so you have to have the cooperation of the administration of hospitals in order to have consumers work on the floors. I think that's the secret, is to get the clearance from on top so that you can work on it in the hospital.
Yeah.
These were mental hospitals. New Haven, well, there were mental hospitals or mental health wards in the regular hospital. In other words, in New Haven, Yale New Haven Hospital had 10 floors, and on the 10th floor were the consumers, and the other floors were other people with physical illnesses. Let me tell you briefly about a program that I started in the hospitals. I didn't only start it, I worked with people on it. We found that there were many people coming in crisis into the hospitals, and the hospitals didn't have staff to take care of them. So what they did was, while they waited for their evaluations, they put them in restraints on gurneys in the hallway. So they're tied down on beds in the hallway. Terrible thing, and they got worse, really. You can imagine, coming into crisis and being tied down on a bed, you know, would make you even worse. So they had a special part of the emergency room that was for psychiatric patients waiting for their evaluations. What we did was we put peer support specialists in the psych emergency room so that when people came into the hospital, they could come to us, we could give them a blanket, give them a soda, talk with them, tell them about the hospital procedures. They didn't have to be tied down anymore. They could sit and wait. We sat and wait with them for their evaluation. So that decreased the tension in the ER, and it really created a new role for consumers, not only in that hospital, but the word got around, and two other hospitals in the city also had consumers working in their ERs, with people in psychiatric emergency or crisis.
Was it voluntarily or a pain job?
It was a pain job, yeah. Yeah. You want to hear something really funny? The regular ER at the Yale New Haven Hospital, they didn't have anything like peer support, so they hired us to work in the regular ER too, to help people with physical illnesses. Why? Because consumers know what it's like to be in crisis and to wait for a long time in a waiting room, and how terrible that is. So waiting with them and talking to them and giving them a magazine was something very welcoming and something that the hospital saw the value of. Where else? Somebody who hasn't spoken. Over there. Right.
A very big difference. Because most of the things you were talking about, we did. We have already been doing these things. Health support groups, a telephone line, all kinds of things. But many of these things, as Ali said, were shut down. And there is not, we don't have money from the
government.
Yes.
Well,
there's a lot of
it's
more
yes. there was a lot of stigma here in the hospital in the emergency room program that we went in. They are very reluctant to have us come in. And what we had to do was, and this takes money, I know, what we did was we created a part-time position in the hospital to have someone supervise our peers when they worked in the emergency room. The hospital would not let them work alone. They had to have supervision. That's the way hospitals work, right? Anyway, we were lucky enough, I think we had to raise like $20,000 to pay that person for a part-time work. But you know something? In the United States, the things that I'm describing are not that well established. And sometimes with, especially when mental health departments have a cut in budget, okay, they eliminate these programs. These programs are the kind of the newest programs, and you know what the saying is, the last hired is the first fired. Well, our programs oftentimes are the first ones that are cut when they have budgetary cutbacks, okay? So it's a real problem. You've got to really advocate. You've got to make friends with people in powerful places so that these programs can continue. Who else? Okay, let me talk about... let me give you another definition. 10 minutes? Oh, my God. Okay, I'm going to talk about... Have you already had telephone lines in the evening? Like not suicide lines, not crisis lines, but we call them warm lines. Warm lines are a chat line that works from 5 o'clock in the afternoon to 10 o'clock at night. It's a helpline. It's to cover the evening when the agencies are closed, when they can't get to mental health professionals, they call us. We're consumers. We're trained to take calls, to be a good listening ear, to be a good friendly voice. We help people get through their day in a more healthy way. The way our warm line works is that at 5 o'clock, the persons work in their homes. They punch in a code, and the 800 number comes into the person's home, and the person receives the calls. And then at 10 o'clock, they punch in another code, and the line goes back to my office phone. So it's only open 5 hours a day, 7 days a week, 365 days a year. And people earn minimum wage for their work. In other words, the minimum wage in the United States is $8.50 an hour. So they earn that much. And it's 5 hours a week. Every 2 weeks we have a business meeting, and everybody is given individual supervision by the coordinator one time a month. We get about 300 calls a month, about 10 a night. And I think we do a lot of good because we help people get the reassurance they need to go to sleep, to live out to be comfortable in their homes during the day. I think I mentioned earlier that like 90% of consumers in the United States live independently in their own apartments. So you know, at night it gets lonely. People get fearful. They can call the warm line. They can talk about their days, get some reassurance. They can get a friendly voice and conversation going. We tend to get the most isolated people. And what we do is we help those people learn how to go out into the community, to take part in community activities, and to reach out for other people for new relationships. It's a successful program. There are 10 warm lines in Connecticut. I started two of them, and I started a warm line coalition of all 10 warm lines because people in the psychiatric field who are in a supervisory position or, let's say, leadership position with other peers oftentimes get isolated. They're not really peers any longer, and they're not mental health professionals. They kind of live in a kind of a limbo. And so I recognize this. We brought them together so they can support one another. We standardized trainings. We worked on trouble spots and improved the warm line system throughout Connecticut. Does this sound something familiar? Have you done this before? Yes?
We're not done. Each other and
Let me speak about that, for example. We call those crisis calls when people are thinking about hurting themselves or hurting other people. What we do in that case is we try to get their name and phone number, and then we call a crisis service that's in the city where there's a psychiatrist on duty. We give the person, the psychiatrist, the name and phone number of the person in crisis, and they call the person to evaluate whether they should come to the hospital or not. Yes.
And sometimes, if you live near him or her, you should take him to the emergency room by yourself.
Yes.
And they did it.
That's wonderful. You know, let me talk about the cost of the warm line. With a coordinator that works, backs up the operators at night, and the operators, the seven operators, and maybe an alternate operator, it costs around $20,000 a year to sponsor the warm line. That's very inexpensive. $20,000, like 60,000 shekels a year to operate a telephone service 5 hours a night every day of the year. That's pretty good. Are any people here from the government? You should hear that.
They left?
Oh, yes? Okay, sure.
You know, I hear you in the last 10 minutes, and I feel like I'm in a kind of dream. because I very much hope that 10%, not 100% from what you explained to us here and now will be translated in the reality of the people that need the help in real time, only 10%, because the first of all, Israel is not a social state.
Right.
They are not caring about this thing. So, government, they don't keep these things. You can't come even from 1% from what you show us now. There is small things that you can handle with them. But in the end, also the situations in the hospitals, you can't even come into the departments because you kick out from there. You can't come inside and speak with nobody.
Yeah.
You can't make this all the stuff that you make in States, God bless America and George Bush, that give you the opportunity to make all those things. And in the level of the something important.
Yeah.
Here the sick people are not important.
Yes, that's
true. They are part of 100% of people they are sick with all the diseases, not the psychiatric diseases.
The United States is not that different than Israel because it doesn't really, how should I put it, it doesn't take care of people with disability. They give them very little money to live on, and they prefer not to think about them. So what we find is that you've got to be really strong advocates. You have to invite the politicians to your centers, have breakfast with them, educate them. Tell them what your life is like, what you need. Tell them your stories. Tell them what works for you. That educational process is something that goes on every year in the United States. We try to get to our politicians because they make the laws that govern mental health services. And you've got to become a strong advocate. Do I have 5 minutes? Let me talk about another project very briefly, just to kind of wind up. The name of this project is the Welcome Basket Project, and I started it because when I got out of the hospital after 5 weeks in the hospital, I was very disoriented in the community. Everything in the hospital was done for me. There were people around taking an interest in me. There was food, there was medication, exercise. When I went home, I was all by myself. So I'd do everything by myself. And I noticed that I had slowed down a lot in the hospital, that people around me were talking fast, they were moving fast. I felt very out of it. And so I thought, geez, you know, why don't we have a program where consumers help the people coming out of the hospitals kind of transition into the community in a good and quick way. So what we did was we met people in the hospitals. We set up an appointment with them in their homes. We met them in their homes. We gave them a welcome basket. In the United States, we have a tradition that when new people come into the community, you have a welcome wagon of people from the neighborhood come to the new person and say, look, we're here, we're your neighbors. Is there anything you need? Well, let me tell you about this community, this neighborhood, etc. We thought that was a nice tradition, so we did the same thing with a welcome basket of plants, food, toiletry articles, where we welcome people into the community after they are in a hospital, and we said, look, we're here to help you. What do you need? We'll help you do it. And so we started this program called the Welcome Basket, and we'd work for people for two or three weeks, maybe a month, until they were transitioned and acclimated into the community again. They're going to their appointments, they're up to the rhythm of the community, they were back on their feet again, then we would leave them and see other people in the hospital. Now let me just tell you one last thing about the Welcome Basket. We did a study of it. I was working at Yale, we had some Yale researchers, did a study of the Welcome Basket clients and a random group of clients. And one of the reasons why people were our clients was they were revolving door clients. In other words, they went in and out of the hospital all the time. So we took them as our clients, and we found that they had a 67% less rehospitalization rate than the random population, the random group that we studied. 67% less going into the hospital. And if they went into the hospital, they stayed an average of 2 days, and the people from the random group stayed 13 or 14 days in the hospital. Well, hospitalization for 1 day in the United States costs around $1,200, okay? Well, that's very expensive. So the administration of the hospital, this is to your point back there. The administration of the agency said, hey, they're saving us some money here. They're saving us a lot of money. Let's support the Welcome Basket. The program started in 1995, and it's still going on because we're saving the system a lot of money. So it's cheaper to have our service than not to have our service. You see what I mean? That's the Welcome Basket. Not maybe. Well, maybe you have to convince some people that it's better to employ you guys to work with other consumers than it is with the more expensive mental health staff. I want to talk a little bit about, just let me finish with this. I want to talk about some of the ethical issues of working with consumers in peer support, okay? We have definite rules that we go by. For example, if you're a warm line operator, you can't date a caller, okay? In fact, we don't allow people to meet with callers outside the warm line. Now, some warm lines do, my warm line doesn't. You're there to help them, you're not there to have a new friend. You're there to help and to help them do what they need to do and let them help them find new friends. So there's no dating, no socializing outside of the warm line. Same thing with the Welcome Basket. Also, we don't like people to loan money. We don't allow people to loan money. We don't allow people to accept gifts over $5 for a gift. In other words, we want to just provide a service and we don't want to entangle ourselves with the people that are receiving the service. That would be too very messy, and it would be, I think, a bad thing because we were there as professionals, not as people looking to make new friends or new boyfriends or girlfriends. Okay? That's a little bit about the ethics of what we do. Any other questions, comments? I think it's almost time for lunch. Mm-hmm. Yes? Okay, how do we help people that are homeless? Well, there are a lot of people that are homeless in the United States. Connecticut has a very large homeless population because Connecticut is a wealthy state and has very little low-income housing. So people that don't have a lot of money can't find apartments. They can't find places to live. So what do? They live on the street, and oftentimes they get picked up by the criminal justice system and they go in jail. Like 15% of the jails in Connecticut are filled with consumers because there's no place for them to go. Or else they go to shelters or they go to a long-term hospital. So this is a big problem still. And it's a problem that's what I call a structural problem because it won't be solved until the state decides to create more low-income housing for people like consumers. Okay, is that a good enough answer? Okay. Anybody else? Yes.
These are most consumers, they integrate into the traditional roles that are in the metabolic system. There are almost no special roles for consumers, like what you described.
Peer support, or?
People are working as peer supporters, but mm-hmm. traditional work, in traditional jobs that also non-consumers do. Mm-hmm. So can you compare the two
Yes. That can be a problem for us too. We call that being co-opted. In other words, to be sort of like assistants to the other mental health professionals. We try to avoid that by for one thing, saying that we have a role that's very specific to our training, which is peer support. In other words, we're there to help people decide what they want to do. We're help people get the resources they need for their own goals. We're there to share our experiences if that seems like a good idea. In other words, we're there to do things that are different from the other staff. And I'll tell you something, things that consumers can do that the staff can't do. For example, engage people. You know, once you meet somebody, you say, look, I've had that problem. I've been in crisis, but I know what you're going through. Let's see if we can work out some way that you can help you get through that. See what I mean? That's something the staff can't do. They won't do it because their training doesn't allow that. So we can do that. Another thing that we can do is we can get information from people much more easily and much quicker than the staff can. There was in one of the intake services, we had a consumer working with people coming into the agency. She sat down with a person in crisis, talked to her for half an hour. She got more information from that person than the regular mental health social worker got in 3 years. So there are definite strengths that consumers bring into the organization or the field when they're allowed to be peer support specialists using their skills as peer support specialists. Okay. Well, thank you very much for listening. We're going to have a program this afternoon.